morning, everyone. Today is April 26th, and we are excited to be together again for the Lord to minister right into your hearts, into your homes. What a wonderful opportunity we have to continue to glorify the Lord. I know we're not gathering, but the Lord is still with us. I want to assure you of that, and I'm excited about the days ahead. I'm excited about how God is leading us through this season, and I believe the Lord has a word for you today. I'll be preaching in a little bit about the message, A Day of Small Things. We'll be coming from Zechariah chapter 4, but before we get into that, I want to give you an opportunity to just kind of do what the Word of God says. You know, at Lakeside Church, one of the things that we had been doing for a while is exhorting one another. We call it one anothering here. And what we do is we take a scripture and we just kind of share it into the hearts of the people as part of our reasons for gathering is to encourage one another, to uplift one another. Let me give you this scripture and then I'm going to have you do that very thing. But it comes from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 3. The word says, but encourage one another daily as long as it is called today. In other words, we need to exhort each other, encourage each other in the moment that we're in, not waiting until 3 weeks from now, a month from now, who knows what's going on down the road. But God says, I've given you today to be an encourager. So what I want to have you do in just a little bit, I want you to grab the device you're using, whether it's your phone, your computer, your iPad, but I want you to be an encourager. I want you to greet those in the body of Christ all over the country. Please understand, it's not just Lakeside people that tune in to the message. There's people from all over the country, all over the world that are watching these messages. I want you to be an encouraging people today. And so just give out a shout. Find people, whether you know them or not, let them know how much God loves them. Maybe share a favorite scripture of encouragement. And while the video is playing, I just want you to take time and follow what God is giving you to do right there. So here is the thing. We have a representative from our nursery ministry who is also going to greet you, and then we'll go into that video. I want you to make sure you watch the screen, because if you look away, if you walk away, you're going to miss it. It's a quick greeting from one of our representatives. I love him a lot, but I want you to be blessed by him, because this is how excited God is to see you as well. And all God's people said, praise the Lord. Amen, amen. Thank you for taking time to greet one another and sending out words of encouragement. You know, these have been continued to be trying times for people, whether it's in their health, whether it's in their labor. I know that people are facing challenges all over the place, and we are all saying, hey, I'm ready for this thing to be over, and I'm ready to move ahead. And today, that's kind of where I want to go. You know, we have heard reports that states are lifting various versions of stay at home. and working into different phases, whether it be in small businesses, small gatherings, and it even includes eventually releasing the church to be able to gather together in worship and celebration once again. And some people might even call it, well, it's the light at the end of the tunnel. We hope this to happen soon. We know that we're still a few weeks away from gathering here at Lakeside at the very least. But in all of that said, I am very personally excited about this. I'm also, though, very concerned. And let me tell you why. Because you see, some people will just look at this as if they're just coming out of a dark time. They're ready to get back to some sense of normalcy. Really, what they're saying is, I want to get back to the old routine that I once had. I want to get back to the routines of society and culture. But you see, instead of looking at this as coming out of a dark time, in my prayer life and what God is speaking into me is, I see this more as an on-ramp to a road that leads us to where we've never been. It's more like an on-ramp getting onto a road that goes to where we have never been. This season of quarantine has had its challenges at every level. But I think we need to settle down, be still before God, and ask some very important questions. What is God speaking through this season? What are we learning about God? What are we learning about Christ's calling for ourselves and the call for the church? What are we learning about the presence of the Holy Spirit? What are we learning about the mission we're supposed to be about? And what are we learning even about ourselves? These are very important questions that I believe that God is speaking into if we will take the time to be still before God. One of the things that I believe the Holy Ghost has given my heart is this. We've heard these called unprecedented times. And in unprecedented times, God is looking to do unprecedented things. Let me say it again. In unprecedented times, God is looking to do unprecedented things. And I think we need to invite Him to do so. You see, in 2 Chronicles 16 and 9, it says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth, that He might move strong on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to Him." God is looking for places where He can do unprecedented things. So as we venture forward, as we plan ahead, what is the church supposed to be doing differently? What are you supposed to be doing differently? You know, sometimes I think we are looking forward with anticipation for familiar days. I want to get back to the routine, the very same things, though, that we used to complain about, the busy schedules, whether they come from sports, maybe even from church. Maybe it's because work has got certain kinds of tension, and we just want to get back to that, calling that the normalcy. And I think that God is saying, no, I'm leading you to somewhere else. I'm leading you into something else. Rather than looking forward with anticipation of familiar days, I want to challenge you to prepare with expectation for a new day. I feel that's what God is speaking into my heart, and that's why the text this morning starts with just this one verse from Zechariah chapter 4, verse 10. "Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin." Let me set this up. It's a new day. It's a new day. That's the feeling and the experience Israel had when they had come out of exile. After being in captivity to the Babylonians, serving in slavery, they had been there as many as 70 years. 60,000 people returned to Jerusalem, hoping to come back to a place where things will get back to normal. They can get back into the routine of the past. God speaks through three primary prophets. They are Ezra, Zechariah, and Haggai. When you take those three books of the Bible, they are all called post-exilic prophets. Or post-exile prophets. After they returned, God uses these prophets to speak some things. But as far as these 60,000 people, they have returned to a familiar place, but when they get there, nothing is familiar. It was certainly a time when nothing was familiar about their life. Everything had been burned. Everything had been destroyed. The temple, the walls, the gates, their homes, everything had been demolished. In reality, they returned to a physical view of what was their spiritual condition when they went into captivity. It was in disarray. There was destruction. And of all things, there was definitely disruption. But this new day had given a new opportunity. Come on, I want you to lean in on this. The opportunity that God had given Israel was not for them to go back to what was, but He had given them an opportunity to move ahead into what should be. What was? What were things like when they went into this captivity? Well, they were full of idolatry, disobedient. They had their priorities all wrong. God wasn't the center of their life. In fact, they still recognized God was around. It's not like they avoided Him. They still did some of the God things, but their primary objective was to do their life. They were wanting to live their lives for themselves and just do God whenever they could instead of living their lives for God and bringing God into their life. They weren't doing that. Does this sound familiar? Sounds like where our culture has been, especially in the kingdom. God had given them a new opportunity on a new day to move ahead into what should be. So the first thing that God did through the prophets was to establish God at the center of their life. They anointed Jeshua. Sometimes people call him Joshua in other translations. But they anointed Jeshua as the high priest. And the work of the priest, of course, was to lead the work of the temple. They also appointed a man by the name of Zerubbabel to be the foreman, to lead the work on the temple, to lead the work of rebuilding the structures of the temple. But before they touched anything, before they rebuilt the temple, before they invested into their homes, before they restored the walls or put back up the gates, before they did anything, the first thing they did was rebuild an altar. And the second thing they did right after rebuilding the altar was they started implementing again the feasts. They reinstated the feasts of God. Now, why did they do this? Number one, they built the altar because, you see, God's got to be the primary focus. To reinstate the feasts of God, it was so that they could remember that God had been faithful. They had to remember the promises that God had given them because, you see, you don't want to move forward into a new land without the promises of God going ahead of you. They reinstated the feasts of God because they wanted to remember, the power of God. I want you to think about this. Deuteronomy chapter 6, they had been given a word. You are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. He talked to them about, God gave them this command to teach your children again and again and again and again. Find ways to teach them. Teach them when you're in the home. Teach them when you're going about the road, going about your day. Teach them when you go to bed and teach them when you rise up. It was constantly keep God at the center, personally and of your conversation. So many things in the routine, let's be honest. So many things when we talk about getting back to normal, much of it does not involve God. God wants to be at the center. I'm not excited about coming back to a church, into a building and with a gathering where people just want to park where they've always parked, sit where they've always sat, and be what they always were. That does not excite me, and I know it's not exciting God. It's a new day. We're beginning a new day. these actions of building the altar and re-implementing the feasts were a declaration that God would be at the center of their faith, He was at the center of their community, and He would be at the center of their families. However, in a short amount of time, the people reverted to centering back on themselves and chose to focus on themselves rather than centering on God. They were striving to work on fleshly things and had gotten off track again. Home life and personal agendas had quickly become their focus. The people reverted to the struggles of their past generations. When you read the prophetic narratives, you can see that God addressed three different traps that the Israelite people had succumbed to. Ezra, Zechariah, and Haggai speak to these three things. They spoke to their shallowness of the spiritual things. They spoke to their hypocrisy, and they spoke about their sin. The shallowness is described as people that were just going through the motions, doing the right thing, but their hearts weren't involved. The depth of the soil, as the Word of God says, that there's a time when the seed gets sown, but because the soil is so shallow, it doesn't take root to survive. We get excited about things so quickly, but then no depth of soil, no rootedness in your life to the Word of God will leave you a shallow Christian. They had no vision. They had no understanding. They addressed the hypocrisy. That word pseudo that's there, pseudo is a way of speaking of imitation. It's a fake. It's got the appearance of it, but it's not really it. It's pseudo Christianity, pseudo church, being an imitation. They weren't genuine. You might recall that Jesus had addressed he had challenged us not to be hypocrites. That word hypocrite, it wasn't such a negative connotation. It was a real terminology they used for actors. They were play actors. That, you know, when you talk about drama, sometimes they use an icon of masks. One's got a smile and the other one's got a frown. And you might recall that back in the day when they played multiple characters, they came out with one mask that would play act like one way, but then wear another mask at another time, to display that I'm somebody different. That was a hypocrite. And they definitely were guilty of hypocrisy. They were play acting. They addressed the sin. And as we understand from Romans 3:23, that sin is a separator from God. There's no moving forward into God's presence without repentance of our hearts for the sin in our lives. They were guilty of sin because through disobedience, through giving attention and allowing the influences of an idolatrous people around them, it caused them to influence their heart away from God. There was separation. They had become a people that were spiritually apathetic, and it led to their discouragement. They had quit, literally quit, working on the temple. They had a good beginning with an altar. They had a good beginning with the feasts. But in a short amount of time, because they lost their focus, they lost what was most important. For 16 years, they didn't touch the temple. They chose rather to focus on getting their own lives back to normal without God at the center. This is what leads us into Zechariah chapter 4, where Zechariah is writing about several visions that he has had. Namely, this one that's in Zechariah chapter 4, it concerns the two that I had described, Zerubbabel, who is not a priest, he's not a prophet, he's not a king, he's not a judge, he's a construction worker, he's a man who's skilled to do building work. And he was given responsibility to lead in the work of rebuilding the temple. Joshua, the high priest, These visions concerned both of them when we get into Zechariah chapter 4. And the primary point of this was this, what was this right here. God wasn't going away and his plan had not changed. Just because their priorities had gotten off track, just because they quit and it seemed like nothing's going on, nothing's going to happen anyway, it didn't change God. He still had the same plan. In a time when everyone was overwhelmed, God says for them to trust the Spirit to finish the work. This is where we get the words in Zechariah 4:6. We've repeated them many times. We've sung about it, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. I want you to think about this. It's not another lesson or a lecture that they needed. It wasn't another activity or an event. They didn't need another thing to do. They didn't need a new song. They didn't need somebody else to preach another message. What they needed was this. They needed the Spirit of God again. Not by might, nor by power. But God said, I'm going to finish the work by my Spirit. I'm learning that there are three ways we can attempt to do the work of God. We can trust our own strength and wisdom. We can borrow the resources of the world, or we can depend on the power of God. My heart is committed to the latter. I want to depend on the power of God. Those first two approaches, they may have good fruit, they may have opportunity to succeed, but in the end, they both are going to let us down. We're limited in those areas. It's only by God's Spirit that anything of lasting value is accomplished. I hope you will take that with you today. It's only by the Spirit of the Lord that anything of lasting value is accomplished. We're not called to trust our abilities. We're not called to trust our talents, our skills, our strength, or our knowledge. All of these things fall short, but we are called to trust the Spirit of God to finish the work that He started within us. Is that not the word that God gave us in Philippians 1:6? Being confident, that means to be persuaded, to trust in, to believe in it. Cling to this very thing, that He who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Like you, I have said many a times, Lord, I feel like sometimes I'm doing two steps forward or one step forward and two steps back. I feel like I'm losing ground instead of gaining ground. God says, quit trying to do it on your own. Trust in me, abide in me, and I will get it done in you. God's going to finish the work that He started in each of us. God's going to finish the work that the church is called to be investing in. God's going to see everything through to the end. His plan still has not changed, no matter what the culture says, no matter what the news says. We trust in the Lord. We still stand on this promise from God, from Joshua chapter 1, verse 9, that this is His command to be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. God is with us. God's leading the way. Somebody say amen. They come to a turning point. I like to call it even a tipping point. The angel of the Lord gives Zechariah one other word for a discouraged people. God speaks these words to them. Verse 10 brings us back to the text that I started with. Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. In the NIV, it states it as a question. Who dares despise the day of small things? Come on. Look at that word, to despise. It literally means to hold as insignificant, to treat with contempt, or to scorn. Just to give you a couple of examples, there's Esau. It said in Genesis 25:34 that Esau despised his birthright. He considered that the birthright that he was to receive was something insignificant. It's no big deal. And because it was insignificant to him, it was taken from him and given to another. We can see new opportunities that God is giving us as insignificant. We can see our skills, our talents as insignificant. And God says, well, I'll just take it away from you. In 2 Samuel 16, you could read verses 14 through 22 to understand the whole context, but David is leading a procession with the Ark of the Covenant back into Jerusalem. He's going to put it back in the temple, and David is so excited. They have worship going, praise is going on. He's dancing before the Lord, unashamed. But Michal, his wife, who is also Saul's daughter, looks down from their window and sees her husband dancing. And the word of God says, and she had contempt for him. She despised what he was doing. And because she despised him, understand, the whole point of that was this. God caused her to be barren. Just as Michal acted with contempt towards David's celebration that left her barren, we can act with contempt towards small beginnings God has given to us, and our lives become ineffective. They become barren in God's plan. I want to build on this right here. Do not despise the day of small things. Do not despise the day of small beginnings. You see, everywhere I look in Scripture, everything and everyone that we called big only got there because of what God had done. They started off small, but it became big. They became big in God's plan. You see, Moses began as a murderer, then a shepherd on the backside of the mountain, but God made him a deliverer. Joseph, he began as a dreamer, but God made him a preserver of his people. Gideon began as the lowliest in the tribe of Benjamin, but God made him a warrior of liberation. David began as a shepherd boy who was seen as the runt of the family, but God made him into Israel's greatest king. Nehemiah, he began as a measly cupbearer for the king, but God made him into a leader who would get the walls built in Jerusalem. Peter, he began as a fisherman, but God made him a preacher of the gospel. Paul began as a religious man and a murderer, but God made him into a church planter for the nations. Jesus began as a babe in the manger in his human form, but resurrection power gave him authority over hell and grave for eternity. Whatever God started with something small, he said, don't despise where you're at because I'm doing a work in you that is big. It's big in the plan of God. Don't despise the day of small beginnings. It's just the starting place of where God is leading you from. It's the on-ramp to where God is taking us. Don't despise where you are because, you see, He's forming something in you that is important for this next season. You might think I'm just a small business. You might think we're just a small town. You might just want to say, I'm just a small fish, but God's doing something in His people during this time. He's doing something in this day that is leading to an unprecedented work of God. The unprecedented time is ready for an unprecedented work of God. And the eyes of the Lord are looking to and fro throughout the earth that He can move strong on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to Him. Don't underestimate the power of small things. God uses small things. To lead the Israelites out of Egypt, Moses surrendered a shepherd's rod to the use of the I Am. To defeat Goliath, he gave David a stone and a sling to knock him down. To defeat the Midianite army, it took a small band of soldiers, 300 of them. They carried pitchers, torches, and a shout in the middle of the night, and they found victory. He preserved a woman by the name of Rahab and her family. She was a prostitute. All she had to do was take a small scarlet thread, hang it in the window, and God used it to save her entire family. To feed 5,000, a small boy surrendered his 5 loaves and 2 fish. And while the disciples were saying, but what's that among so many? Jesus was saying, that's enough if you'll release it. It may be small, but there's a big work that God wants to do to turn the world right side up. No, I'm not talking about upside down. It's already upside down. But to turn a world right side up, God took 120 who were social distancing from society. But while they were social distancing, they were leaning into the throne room of heaven. And God filled them with the power of the Spirit. And by the end of the day, there were 3,000 who were walking with them. Don't tell me that God can't use small things. You might think this is an insignificant time, but I want you to know God says, don't despise this. This is the beginning of something new. Never despise the day of small beginnings, for when God is glorified, even in the small things, He will use it to accomplish great things. Let me go to the next point. Faithfulness in small things leads to blessings in big things. Let me say that again. Faithfulness in small things lead to blessings in big things. I need you to lean in on this. The principle is this. We get what we plant for. Yes, that's how I said that. That leaders will say you will get what you plan for, but God says you will get what you plant for. 2 Corinthians 9:6 gives us this instruction. Remember this. Don't forget it. A farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop. But the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. We will get what we plant for. This may be a planting time. You want to see God do unprecedented things, then you're going to have to start seeing it first in your own life. God, do something unprecedented in me. This is a planting season. Small things can also be the test from God. Faithfulness in small things lead to blessings in big things, because then during the small things, it's the test for what could be coming from God. Matthew 25, verse 21, well done, good and faithful servant. Don't you want to hear that someday when we stand before the Lord? Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. A Christian who can't be trusted with the small things can never be trusted with the big things. You must be faithful over the few. Don't despise these small moments. In Luke 16 and 10, he who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. You may think what you have is small, but let me ask you, are you being faithful with it? Are you being faithful with it? Just because you think something is small, you might think your talent's small, your resources are small, you think your position is small, doesn't mean that God's not going to use it for something big if you'll release it. Don't despise small things, because third point, small things will move mountains. Small things will move mountains. Let me revisit again verse 6. Or let me go to verse 7, Zechariah 4:7. It says about Zerubbabel, not even a mighty mountain will stand in Zerubbabel's way. Remember, he's not a priest. He's not a king. He's not a prophet. He's a man who works with his hands. He's been given a responsibility. And God said, it's not by might, not by power, in verse 6, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. And then he goes into, not even a mighty mountain will stand in Zerubbabel's way. So what were the mountains that had risen up in Zerubbabel's way? When God stirred an awakening in the people, saying, come back to my Spirit. Trust it. What is it that God said, these are the mountains that you're facing, but they aren't going to limit what I've given Zerubbabel responsibility to do? The mountains of discouragement among the people, the mountains of opposition from the enemies that were around them, the opposition of poor crops, an unstable economy, people who were not obeying God's law. All of these problems are not too different from our 21st century situation. So let me ask you, are you facing a mountain? Are you facing a mountain? Small things will still move mountains. Don't despise a mustard seed in prayer to move it. Matthew 17 and 20. Jesus said, "For assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you." You know, when I hear people quote that passage, they always leave off those last words. They always talk about, if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, you can speak to the mountain and it has to move, and they leave it there. But Jesus said, "And nothing will be impossible for you." You know what that tells me? That tells me that I can pray in faith and I can act out in faith, believing that God is doing the work that I've prayed for. It is faith in action, not just faith in words. So I want you to add to this question within yourself right now. What mountain do you need to move in prayer and then put your faith into action about? Specifically, I felt like I needed to put this here. If you are facing something right now that is in God's way, if you are facing an individual right now that is in the way of what God, when I say in the way of God, I'm not talking about they're walking in God's ways, they're trying to get in God's way. That's a mountain in your life, and I'm encouraging you to pray against it. Whether it's a situation, if it's people, if it's things, pray against it, move the mountain in prayer, and then act it out in faith. This person, this thing is not in my way. I'm doing what God called me to do. The answer to these problems is prayer that releases the power of the Holy Spirit, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. In these next few moments, I'm encouraging you to spend time together as in a family connect. This is where we go from Lakeside Connect to Family Connect. It's in a time of the Word that we go from the know what the God's Word says, the so what, why does it matter, but now we are to the now what. What are we going to do about this? I want to encourage you that in your family connect to visit three passages of Scripture. The first is Psalms 37, verse 23, talking about the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. There are many people that hear a report from God and they're not excited about it. God said he's delighted in the plan that he has for you. He's delighted about what's coming for his people. Are you excited about what God is excited about? Are there steps in your life that you've been dreading that God may be delighting in? And let me say that there may be steps in your life that you are that are absolutely leaving you miserable. And I want to add to that point, anything that you're doing other than what God gave you to do will always make you miserable. Doesn't matter how much it pays. Doesn't matter how much it attracts. If it's not what God wanted, it's going to leave you miserable. I want to warn you. When you refuse to take small steps forward, you will eventually find yourself taking big steps back. Just like Israel, and you're going to find yourself back in a bound life. I'm encouraging you to read Luke 16 and 10. I had that in the message, but I'm going to answer the question, are you being faithful with the small things? Are you being faithful about your talents, or is that instrument sitting in a closet? Are you being faithful with the talent that God has given you to sing or to write? Or have you pushed that off to the side saying, oh, that's too little for God to use? God said, don't you despise the small things I've given you. Are you being faithful with the small things? And then lastly, I'm encouraging you to look at Matthew 17 and 20 again about the mountains. What mountains in your home? What mountains in your family do you need to be moving through prayer and then starting to take action on in faith? You see, I don't think the Word of God just comes to us in a way that says, tell us what we need to know. The Word of God is there to transform us. And if we're not willing for God's Word to confront us, then we're not willing to be transformed. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, I pray now for every home and every family, the shepherds of their homes, the patriarchs and matriarchs who have bowed their heads with me. Fill these next moments. Cause them to hear your voice. Confront us and change us by your Spirit. I pray, Lord, that when they begin to talk, when they begin to discuss, let them not be hypocritical, let them not be shallow, but God, I pray this time you're using to dig down deeper. You're causing the word to take root. Lord, bless this time. Anoint it in Jesus' name. Amen. When your family is done in the Family Connect, I want to encourage you to come back to the Facebook page for a song that has become one of my favorite prayer time songs during this year. I believe it's called Make Room, but it challenges us about our traditions. It challenges us about our foundations. We need to surrender these things to the Lord. If something's not of God, then Lord, that's not what I want to build on. The Lord's doing a transforming work during this season. What you're calling small or just the beginning, God is leading us somewhere. Amen. God bless you.